Let me move on. Dad, at the Center for Muslim Christian Understanding, it gives me great pleasure to introduce Bishop Nazir-Ali. He's an old friend. He was with me on the dialogue of the Anglican Church with Al-Azhar, and he speaks impeccable Arabic. He gave a lecture to the Azharites in really classical Arabic, and you all have read his bio, so he has a lot to tell us, and we have a lot of questions, so I'm going to let him speak.
Thank you.
Well, thank you very much indeed. I've heard so much about this center, and it's so good to see Dr. Haddad again. She was a very considerable presence in the dialogue with Al-Azhar al-Sharif and was respected on both sides equally, I think I can say with some confidence, on the Muslim side as well as on the Christian side. So you are entirely the right person, I think, to be here at the center, madam.
Thank you.
I'm sure many other people have said the same thing. Well, given the title of the talk, obviously there is quite a lot to say, and I won't beat about the bush. Do continue with your lunch. I will eat mine afterwards. I thought that was discretion being the better part of valor in this case. I want to say something, first of all, about the importance of personal experience. The priority of the personal in the spiritual. This is often ignored when we talk about Muslim-Christian relations, but certainly the medieval Christian mystics, whether it's Teresa of Avila or Catherine of Siena or Hildegard of Bingen, all three women, by the way, each of them in her own way emphasizes how important the personal dimension of the spiritual is. And in the Islamic context, similarly, Ibn Khaldun, as far as I know, is the first to recognize the importance of personal spiritual experience. And indeed, he relates it very interestingly enough to what today we call the subliminal self. And I think Ibn Khaldun is the first to link religious experience with psychology in that sense, if you like. in our own day, Peter Berger has pointed to the importance of the signals of transcendence, as he calls them, for the personal aspect of the spiritual. And Ibn Khaldun's thinking was picked up by Allama Muhammad Iqbal, the alleged founder of Pakistan. We won't go into that aspect of it. But one of the things that Iqbal says is that you cannot contest the fact of spiritual experience. It is there, it happens to people, and you have to make sense of it. I say all of this because the encounter between Muslims and Christians at that level, between the Christian mystics of the deserts of Egypt, of Syria, Mesopotamia, and the incipient Sufis, is very important for the history of Muslim-Christian relations and of dialogue, and is very often ignored. But I hope that we can explore something of that story also this afternoon. And the personal is important because that is how people make sense of their lives, how they give direction to their lives, how they give meaning to their lives, whether it is Muslims or Christians or Jews or anyone else for that matter. However, for better or for worse, I will be concentrating this afternoon on the social aspects of the spiritual. And as you know, the word religion implies that already. This is not now about personal spiritual experience, but religion as that force which binds people together. And just as Ibn Khaldun is important for the personal aspect of the spiritual, so of course his notion of Asabiyya, which has been explored so thoroughly by Professor Akbar Ahmed, is relevant here, that there are positive and negative sides to Asabiyya, but religion is certainly one of the ways in which societies are bound together, and their laws, their customs, their values have often, almost universally we could say, arisen from religious belief. Now, secularization theory of course challenges this and claims that the advent of democracy, for instance, and of the welfare state are marginalizing this binding aspect of religious belief. So democracy is now supposed to legitimize what religion legitimized before. And the welfare state now meets the needs of people that religion used to meet before. I mean, this is the kind of thesis of the British School of Sociology, Brian Wilson, for instance. But given the fact of secularization, I do wonder whether this is exaggerated, whether democracy can or does legitimize everything. I mean, when we are talking about fundamental freedoms, about human dignity, about equality, very often, even in the course of making law, we have to invoke transcendental principles that are not just about counting numbers. Secondly, does the welfare state deliver everything? I mean, the psychiatrist who said recently on television that he could prescribe Prozac for people who were depressed, but he couldn't give them meaning in life. And things like loneliness, relationships, happiness. The Prime Minister in Britain is very interested in happiness these days. I mean, these are not things that the welfare state can provide with all the best intentions in the world. So even if you accept the secularization thesis, we can't say that democracy and the welfare state have replaced the value of religious belief. Indeed, Brian Wilson himself says at the end of his book on this subject that the decline of religion will affect civilization as such in the Western world. And this view is also echoed by many other people. Now, the cohesive aspect then of religious belief is one side of the picture, whether we think of Asabiyya or in some other way. But where Judaism, Islam, and Christianity are concerned, there is another aspect which is also very important, and that is the prophetic aspect. You know the famous story told by Iqbal, actually, in one of his books about a mystic who said, by God, Muhammad of Arabia went to heaven and came back. If I had gone to heaven, I would never have come back. And Iqbal says this is the difference between the mystic and the prophet, that the prophet has an obligation to society, to work in society and to change society in line with the prophetic vision. This aspect, as I say, is particularly true of Judaism, Islam, and Christianity. But it can't be limited to them, even so, because, for instance, we find Buddhism can be examined in many different ways, of course. But one way to think of Buddhism is to think of it as a radical criticism of the caste system. And much later, the same can be said of Sikhism. Even within Hinduism, the bhakti cult, for instance, is anti-caste and therefore a social criticism of society generally. So we have the cohesive aspect of religion, prophetic witness, and to that we might also add prophetic struggle, because the witness is not just it's not just words, it can actually be also in terms of action. And all of these pose questions for Muslims, Christians, and Jews in our world today. Now you will say immediately, you are painting a very rosy picture of religion. And so I would like to acknowledge straight away that there is a dark side to religion, whichever religion it may be. Religions can and do go wrong very badly. I was in Bosnia during the Civil War on behalf of Christian Aid. Our aim in being there was to try, along with Islamic Relief, to deliver supplies to people regardless of confession. In this, we were only partly successful because the communities were so badly divided. But I saw there at first hand how religion, in this case a Christian version of it, can become allied to a very nasty kind of nationalistic chauvinism. It's not limited, of course, to Bosnia or to the Balkans. I mean, who would have imagined after Mahatma Gandhi that India would be lurching even today to a kind of Hindu chauvinism? And the question that raises, particularly for Muslims and Christians in that country. And of course, the resurgence of Islam has many different factors and dimensions to it. But I have personal experience, as do many of you, of the rise of violent extremism in many Islamic countries, and we need always to ask, well, what is the relationship of this to Islam itself? Just as we had to ask in Bosnia, what is the relationship of this kind of chauvinism to Christianity? So there is a dark side to religion. Religion can and does go wrong, but in this it is not unique in terms of human experience. There are many things in human experience that can go wrong. Many good things. I mean, patriotism can go wrong. Patriotism is a good thing. It's good for us to love our nation. But if it goes wrong, it becomes inward and exclusive and causes havoc for minorities and other groups who are not included. Love can go wrong. I mean, what a noble emotion human love is between parents and children, husband and wife. But we all know, don't we, that if it goes wrong, it causes havoc. So religion is not alone in this possibility of going wrong. And also, too much is sometimes laid at the door of religion as far as conflict is concerned. If you look at the 20th century, for instance, many of the major conflicts of the 20th century were not directly caused by religion. They were caused by secular ideologies, whether it is National Socialism or Stalinism, which arguably caused more suffering than even the Nazis, the Cultural Revolution in China, where they tried to destroy their own culture, and even things like the Ba'ath Party in Syria and Iraq were consciously modeled on the pattern of European fascism of the 1920s and 30s. So, you know, these examples can be multiplied. All I'm saying is don't lay everything at the door of religion. Having said that, two things need to be said immediately. One is that religions need to be, in our world, need to be accountable. And accountable in two ways, principally. One, they need to be accountable at the bar of world opinion. We no longer live in a world where religions can evade such accountability. People sometimes say to me, Bishop, this is an internal matter for us, we will resolve it ourselves. Well, that luxury is no longer available. Religions have to be accountable for what they say and do and teach and practice at the bar of world opinion. You may want to say world opinion also needs to be accountable somehow, but that's a different issue. Secondly, and this is the point for this afternoon, religions need to be accountable to one another. And this is one of the main purposes of dialogue today. Dr. Haddad was talking about our experience of dialogue with Al-Azhar al-Sharif, and it was realistic and robust dialogue. I think you will agree. I am not a believer in what you might call kissy-kissy dialogue, you know, where people pat each other on the back and say how wonderful they are. In this dialogue that we had for many years, our discipline was that each side could suggest a single topic. So one year, Al-Azhar suggested the controversy caused by the Danish cartoons, you remember? And we suggested the situation of Mr. Abdul Rahman, the person in Afghanistan who had become a Christian and had promptly been sentenced to death for apostasy. So it was tough, but out of it came very good things. I remember, I don't know if Dr. Haddad, you were present, but Sheikh Tantawi, the former rector of Al-Azhar, late rector of Al-Azhar, and I did a joint lecture in Cairo. Well, what I said was not important, just as what I'm saying now is not important. But Sheikh Tantawi said in Cairo, in public, that what people believed was not the business of the state. I mean, this was a very brave thing for him to say. And this kind of thing has been echoed by people like Sheikh Ali Goma. So this mutual accountability, especially between Muslims and Christians, is important in our world. And you may say, why Muslims and Christians? Well, for the obvious reason that these are now, for better or for worse, the two great missionary faiths in our world today. They are expanding rapidly in many different parts of the world. And Christians and Muslims are finding themselves cheek by jowl with one another. And the question is, will they find themselves cheek by jowl as good neighbors, or will there be cantonization and conflict? I remember a terrible visit to Kaduna in northern Nigeria, where the person taking me around would say, now this is a Christian area, Bishop, and beyond this bridge is the Muslim area, and so forth. I mean, I just felt it was so sad that this city was cantonized in that kind of way. Now, the point is, ladies and gentlemen, that Muslims and Christians have enormous historic resources to call upon, both positively and negatively, as they consider their relations today and tomorrow. From the very beginning, in the emergence of Islam, certainly as a historical phenomenon, I mean, there has never been a time, has there, when Muslims, Christians, and Jews have not been living together. Whether they have lived together in peace or not is another question, but they have always found themselves living together, and so we have a lot of experience to call upon. The very origins of the Prophet of Islam's consciousness of his own calling and his mission are related in one way or another to Christians. The monk Nastur or Bahira, for example, who is supposed to have recognized signs of authentic religious experience in the Prophet of Islam, or the acknowledged role of Warqa bin Nawfal, the relative of the Prophet's first wife, Khadija. And then I've just come back from Ethiopia, so this is fresh in my mind, the first hijrah. I met with some people in Ethiopia who are called the Habasha, and they claim to be the descendants of the first muhajirin. You know, I don't know if that's historically verifiable, but that's what they claim. And their point is that they are Muslims who have arrived in Ethiopia in peace. And they also say that because the Abyssinians, the Ethiopians gave the Muhajirin refuge, jihad is never legitimate, therefore, against the country of Ethiopia. The refugees arrived, and like all refugees, they were interrogated by immigration officials. But with this exception, this was theological interrogation. See, the officials of the Negus asked these Muslim refugees what they believed about Jesus and his mother. And the refugees said that their prophet had taught them that Jesus was Word and Spirit of God and had been born of a virgin. Now, it was on that basis of theological agreement, if you like, that they were given refuge in Abyssinia. Similarly, when the Christians of Najran came to negotiate with the Prophet of Islam, they came to Medina. They were accommodated in the Prophet's mosque. They were allowed to perform the divine liturgy in the Prophet's mosque. I mean, this is worth remarking because, of course, today, if you attempt to go to Medina or Mecca, you find signs saying that any non-Muslim going beyond this point is liable to the death penalty. But to what extent this is following the Sunnah is a question. Again, the negotiations between the Christians of Najran and the Muslims were based on theological discussion. So the Christians of Najran, after some preliminaries, asked the Prophet whether he believed Jesus was the Son of God. pretty central thing for Christians to ask. Of course, by this time, as you know, Muhammad, the Prophet of Islam, had said already to the Meccans that Allah could not have daughters. You know, one of the reasons for the opposition of the Meccans to him was his denial that Allah could have these three daughters, Al-Lat, Al-Manat, and Al-Uzza, who were the centers of a cult in Mecca that provided a great deal of income for the pagan Meccans. So how could he now say that he had a son? So of course, you know, that's a standard Muslim denial that God can have a son. To which the Christians of the Najran then asked the question, well, whose son is he then? If he's born of a virgin, whose son is he? And as you know, in Arabic, very often people are described in terms of whose son they are. So Osama bin Laden or Abdullah bin Saud or whatever it might be. Ibn Ishaq says that the Prophet of Islam did not give an answer to this question at the time, but the Quran gives two answers to this question. One is the repeated title it gives to Jesus as Isa ibn Maryam, Jesus the son of Mary, which was a term of abuse in terms of Jewish Christian polemics, but it is to Islam's credit that it was turned to a title of honor. Isa ibn Maryam meaning someone who does not have a human father. Now, the other answer that the Quran gives is a counter question, which is, well, whose son was Adam? And just as God had created Adam out of nothing, so he had cast Jesus into the womb of Mary, because, and the expression is used about God, kun fayakunu, God wills and it is. Now, the point is that although there was no complete theological agreement, there was political agreement between the Christians of Najran and the early Muslims in that they were allowed to go back and to continue living in peace in Najran. Relations with the Jews compared to the Christians were more up and down. I mean, in some cases you could say that the relations with the Jews were more intimate. In others, they pose certain problems that we need to explore because they're relevant today. So, for instance, when the Prophet arrived in Medina, very soon after his arrival, he promulged the so-called Sahifat al-Medina, the constitution or the document of Medina, which at least in one reading of it confers rights and responsibilities on both the Muslims, both the Ansar and the Muhajirin, those from Mecca and those from Medina, and on the Jewish residents of Medina, and by implication even the pagan Arabs. I mean, this is quite a remarkable document, and we might say that if there is a foundation document for an Islamic state, this is it. So when people say to me in diverse places, we want to have an Islamic state, I say to them, will it be like the one modeled in the Sahifat al-Madina or not? And if not, why not? But of course, we also know, sadly, that the situation changed very rapidly between the Jews and the early Muslim community. And there was considerable conflict, which I think we also need to record. I mean, the Jews were numerous in and around Medina. The list of tribes in Ibn Ishaq is very impressive, or Jewish tribes, I mean. So the Muslim community in Medina began to suspect the Jews of conspiring with the pagan Meccans. This resulted, first of all, in sanction and then exile for certain Jewish tribes, the Banu Kanuka and the Banu Nadir, for instance, were stripped of their possessions and exiled. And then you know the story of what happened to the Banu Qurayza, who were entirely eliminated. I mean, I say this not to sort of dredge up things unnecessarily, but because these things remain important for us today. The Jewish fort of the Khaybar, which was some way from Medina, the situation was different here. So what we find is that after a siege, a treaty is concluded with the Jews of the Khaybar, in which they are allowed to continue with their agricultural work, which is to produce very fine dates, among other things, as long as they paid a tribute to the Muslims. Now again, this becomes a model for how relations are to be between Muslims and non-Muslims in the future. But for the time being, it's worth recording that both Jewish and Christian communities, Khaybar and Najran, for example, were allowed to continue to remain on the peninsula. After the the passing of the Prophet of Islam, Islam and Muslims spread very rapidly into what was then the Christian Middle East. You know, this is something that people don't often realize, that the great Christian centers at this time were in the Middle East. I mean, barring Rome, the great Christian cities, Alexandria, Damascus, Jerusalem, Edessa, Constantinople, of course, were all there. And they all succumbed very quickly. I mean, Damascus, the gates of Damascus were opened for the Muslim armies by the family Al-Mansur. And who are they? The Christian family from whom later on came the great St. John of Damascus. We've just celebrated Easter in our church. We sang his great hymn, "The Day of Resurrection, Earth Tell It Out Abroad." They opened the gates of Damascus for the Muslim armies. The Byzantine garrison having deserted the city. Jerusalem, you know what happened. The Caliph Umar, when he arrived, the Patriarch Sophronius invited him to pray in the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. Umar refused on the grounds that if he prayed in the church, the Muslims would find that an excuse to turn it into a mosque. And perhaps he was right, because the spot where he did pray, there is now actually a mosque there called the Mosque of Umar. Now, not only the Christian part of the Middle East, but the other part, the great Persian Empire, also succumbed very quickly. Constantinople, of course, it took many hundreds of years for Constantinople to be conquered, but the fairest provinces of the Eastern Roman Empire were gone within 100 years of the Prophet of Islam's death. That is the situation. Now, in that we find, first of all, this is where Banu Qurayza are important, the destruction of certain communities. Khalid bin Walid, who was put in charge by the Caliph Abu Bakr to tackle the Ridha, the great rebellion against Islam in the Arabian Peninsula itself, he was called Saif Allah, the sword of God. in his military campaigns, he was so severe that Umar, the second caliph, had to discipline him and to deprive him of military command. Secondly, the dispersal of communities. So it is not just Banu Qurayza, but the Qanuqa and the Nadir, who are also important, because people were not allowed to remain where they were. So a tradition was discovered that the Prophet had said there could only be one religion in the Khalij al-Arabiya, the peninsula of Arabia, the present Grand Mufti of Saudi Arabia has just delivered a fatwa repeating this point with relevance to the building of churches today. But the result was that the Christians and the Jews who had remained in the lifetime of the Prophet of Islam had to leave. Where did they go? The Jews, we understand from historical testimony, went to the region of Jericho. And the Christians went to Syria and to Iraq. You see, so there's nothing new under the sun in terms of people movements that have occurred down the ages. So there was not just destruction but dispersal, and then there was the introduction of the dhimma. The word dhimma, as you know, means responsibility, and originally meant the responsibility that the Muslims felt for their non-Muslim subjects who were allowed to remain in their countries and at their work, provided they paid a certain poll tax, the jizya, and also if they had land, if they paid the kharaj. But as time went on, these provisions, the conditions under which non-Muslims were allowed to live in the Muslim world, were tightened. So under Umar bin Abdul Aziz, for instance, the so-called Pact of Umar, which prescribes the conditions under which the dhimmis can live in the Islamic domains, is clearly set out. And this is not just about paying tax. This is about limitations on freedom of worship, on participation in political and civic life, in maintaining and building churches and synagogues, and so forth. And this aspect of the dhimma became characteristic of the relations between Muslims and non-Muslims for many hundreds of years. Now, the dilemma about the dhimma is that, on the one hand, you could see it as an advance. It was a way of accommodating a large non-Muslim population. In those days, very large indeed. of Christians and Jews. Later on, it was extended to the Zoroastrians. And the Chachname, the description of the conquest of the Sindh by Muhammad bin Qasim, extends it to Buddhists and Hindus as well. On the other hand, if the Dhimma is regarded as a political program for today, which it has been in recent years, for example, in Iran and Pakistan, then it becomes a problem for common citizenship. However, for the time being, the point worth making is that in spite of this, of these restrictions, there was, of course, a huge development in the emergence of what is often called Islamic civilization. It's called Islamic civilization, but how did it come to be? Who were the people who contributed to this civilization as it emerged, for example, under the Abbasids? Of course, the Muslims who had come from the desert wanted to have a great material and intellectual civilization. The translation schools, for instance, were set up by the caliphs. But who did the translation? The navies of the caliphs were supreme in the seas for centuries, but who built the ships? I mean, this is a long story. What about systems of governance? The role of the Persians in the building of Islamic civilization in terms of governance alone is quite remarkable. But just to take the the main Christian contribution, the translation schools that were set up under Mamun and Harun were staffed almost entirely by Christian clergy of various churches, Nestorian, Melkite, Jacobite, and so on. I mean, the clergy do sometimes have their uses. But you know, just to take one example, Hunan ibn Ishaq and his son Ishaq ibn Hunan, Nestorians, between them translated the whole of the Greek medical corpus into Arabic, and quite a lot of Plato and Aristotle besides. The father was better at Greek, so translated from Greek into Syriac. The son was better at Arabic, so translated from Syriac into Arabic. But this medical corpus was used even in Oxford, I mean the university with which I have some connections, right up to the 18th century. This Greek learning, scientific, philosophical, medical, was then relayed back to Europe. Now this story is often told, but it was relayed back to Europe in two ways, and this is not often said. First of all, by Jewish traders. So we see, for instance, that the form of Islamic names in European languages are often to be found in an Hebraic form. So Ibn Rushd becomes Averroes. Ibn Sina becomes Avicenna, and so forth. Sometimes the translations show how the transmission has occurred. But the other main way in which it occurred was, of course, through the Arabic-speaking communities of the West. Where were they? Well, they were in the Iberian Peninsula, of course. And it was really through them that the monasteries of the rest of Western Europe acquired so much of this learning. So what I'm trying to say is that what is called Islamic civilization was actually created by the cooperation of Muslims, Christians, and Jews, and indeed people who were or had been Zoroastrians. Now, this flow of reason and Feast of Soul, is it the other way around, was interrupted for two main reasons, which I think we have relevance for us today. One was of course the Crusades. The reasons why the Crusades happened are very complex, certainly there was a great deal of barbarity when the Crusaders conquered Jerusalem. I mean, no one can possibly ignore the barbarity of the Crusaders in the conquest of Jerusalem. But certain things need to be said. I mean, the Crusades were called, from the point of view of the West, first because the newly converted to Islam Seljuk Turks were making it impossible for Western pilgrims to go to the Holy Land. At that time, the Holy Land was regarded as the fifth gospel. So, you know, you needed to go if you wanted to understand the first four. Secondly, the Fatimi Caliph Al-Hakim, who I think must have lost his mental balance, completely destroyed the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. He also destroyed many other Muslim holy places, by the way, which is why I think there must be serious questions about his mental balance. But this caused great alarm in Europe at the time, the destruction of the Holy Sepulchre, right down to the tomb itself. And thirdly, of course, Alexius Comnenus, the Eastern Emperor, had directly asked the Pope for help because he was under pressure all the time from the Turks. Now, as I say, a great deal went wrong with the Crusades. The Crusaders became greedy, they were barbaric, although the barbarism cannot be laid only at the doors of one side to the conflict. There was barbarism on both sides, as well as great chivalry. One of the things I often say to my Muslim friends, which sometimes comes as a surprise to them, is that the Crusades were never conducted only against Muslims. So there was a crusade against the Jews. There was a crusade against the Albigensian heretics. And there was also a crusade, of course, against Constantinople. The Latin conquest of Constantinople arguably weakened the city so that it fell later on. In fact, Amin Maalouf, the Arab historian, says that it is the Eastern Christians who suffered the most, because by the Muslims they were regarded as a possible fifth column, and by the West as heretics. So they were caught in the middle. The other great interruption was, of course, the Mongol invasion. You know, this reality of the constant moving of people from Central Asia, nomadic people, into the Middle East and even India and Europe, is something that we must understand if we are going to make any sense of what was going on. But the conquest of Baghdad by the Mongols is absolutely central because when the Mongols conquered Baghdad in 1258, they not only pillaged it but completely destroyed it. And in this, the different communities suffered differently. So the because the Hulaku's first wife was a Nestorian, the Nestorians had a relatively easy time of it. Of course, that Baghdad at that time was the headquarters of the Nestorian church. Some of the Mongols were Shia, so the Shias didn't suffer so much. But the burden of the suffering fell on the Sunnis. I mean, again, this is not just a matter for historical interest, but what I'm trying to say is if you go to Baghdad today, these divisions are very deeply rooted in people's memories, in the collective memories of these communities. One result of the of the Mongol invasions, I mean, the poet Saadi from Iran says about the fall of Baghdad, he says, Muhammad, if you are to come on Judgment Day, come now, because this is Judgment Day. That is how it was seen as an event of apocalyptic significance. One result, of course, of it politically and socially was to end Arab supremacy in the Islamic world for several centuries. Because what now began to happen was that different non-Arab groups, the Mamluks in Egypt and Syria, for instance, but more and more the Turks began to be dominant, and a small tribe, never ignore small tribes, called Osmanli, began to be more and more powerful. And of course, Osmanli results in the Ottoman Empire. And a great deal can be said about the Ottoman Empire, but of significance for us today, there are one or two things that we need to mention. One was that the Ottomans borrowed from pre-Islamic Persia the millet system, the system of defining communities by ethnicity and religion, giving them maximum autonomy to govern themselves, provided they remain loyal to the Ottomans. Now, this became a characteristic of Ottoman rule from the Balkans right up to the Middle East. The second thing that is worth noting about the Ottomans is their claim to the title of caliph. You know, the usual qualifications for a caliph had to be not only that he should be an Arab, but of the Quraysh. So how did a jumped-up Turk come to be a caliph? Neither Arab, and definitely not Quraysh. Because the claim was, because the Ottoman ruler was now the only one who was engaged in jihad. He was the only one now who could be called Ghazi. That was the reason why he could claim to be caliph. And of course, where was he engaged in jihad? Well, many fronts, but particularly southern and eastern Europe. From about the middle of the 19th century, because of Western pressure, the Ottomans began a reform which I think is still important for the Muslim world, summed up in the Tanzimat, in the reform of law generally, but in two firmans. A firman is an order. I mean, firman is a Persian word meaning order. The Khat-e-Sharif of Gulhani, in which there are lots of things in it, but basically this was the abolition of the millet system and of the dhimma. So for the first time since the 7th century, the non-Muslim communities of the Ottoman Empire came to be, in theory anyway, equal citizens with the Muslims. Now, Zionism was already in the air. And the Jews, even of the Islamic world, had their eyes fixed already on the Zionist project, which of course at that time was not geographically defined. You know, it could have been in Brazil or somewhere. Those options were all explored. But the Christians, of course, became enfranchised, even though the leaders of these Christian communities did not particularly like it, because it removed their prominence, as it were. And eventually, within 50 years of the firmans, nationalisms of various kinds began to arise in the Muslim world. So Arab nationalism, which was not so much based on religion, but on the view that Arab culture, language, and history were important. Of course, Islam had a place in all of that as a product of Arab genius, if you like, but not the only place. And the remarkable thing about this rise of Arab nationalism is the numbers of Christians who contributed to the development of Arab nationalist theory. There's a long list of people: Constantine Zurek, Anton Farah, Boutros Ghali, and of course Michel Aflaq, the founder of the Ba'ath Party. Similarly, Turkish nationalism arose because the Ottomans had begun to lose already. Greece was independent in 1833. They had begun to lose their Balkan dominions, and after the First World War, their Arab dominions. And so the question arose, where would the Turks go? You know, so Turkey for the Turks is based on this idea. I mean, we may condemn the way in which modern Turkey has treated its minorities, whether Kurdish or Armenian or whatever, but this is behind, you know, the Turks have nowhere else to go but Turkey. Indian Muslim nationalism, again, which resulted in the creation of Pakistan, was not a theocratic movement at all. It was really a concern that Muslims would be squeezed in Hindu India, and they had to find some space for themselves to properly express their culture and their history and their values and so forth. The fact that Pakistan gradually and increasingly became theocratic is another matter. Now, the point is, why did these nationalisms begin to fade? Why were they questioned, and what came to replace them? They began to fade because there was a realization that they were, in the end, imports, that many of them imitated Western forms of polity, and they were not true in one way or another to Islam. We should not make the mistake of thinking that radical Islamism, for example, has only to do with grievances. You know, it doesn't. I mean, it has a certain political, social, economic program. It is, in that sense, well, not just one comprehensive ideology, but several, because there are several manifestations of it. For instance, Sunni and Shia. But there are certain factors that have led to its growth. That cannot be denied. The experience of imperialism is certainly one of them. So people like Jamaluddin Afghani campaigned relentlessly against the imposition of Western imperialism and also Ottoman corruption. You know, we must not forget that the imperial experience, even in modern times, so much in the Muslim world, is not just Western imperialism, but when Turkey became the sick man of Europe, that as well. Not just imperialism, but what you might call neo-imperialism. And the two examples that immediately come to mind, one, the destabilization and the overthrow of the moderately socialist government of Prime Minister Mossadegh in Iran by Western interests, Anglo-American interests, let's put it bluntly, which reinstated the Shah, because Mossadegh's moderately socialist government would not give the West oil concessions. And what was sown in 1953 was reaped in 1979. I mean, that's, you know, I was supervised at one time by a man who had been responsible, partly responsible, for the overthrow of Prime Minister Mossadegh. So I have some personal knowledge of what happened. The other, of course, is what happened in Afghanistan. Here, the Western powers, along with Pakistan, decided to overthrow the Soviet-backed regime in Afghanistan. In this, they were successful, but in being successful, they also created at the same time what we now recognize as international terrorism. I mean, you know, Arabic has a perfectly good word for a terrorist, Irhabi. But the colloquial word in many Arab countries for a terrorist is not Irhabi, it is Afghan. That is to say, a person who has learned his terrorism on the killing fields of Afghanistan. Not ethnically an Afghan, but a person of any nationality. So neo-imperialism, failure of both capitalism and of command economy socialism in the Muslim world. Command economy socialism was tried in Syria, Egypt, many countries, and had the same results it's had everywhere, inefficient production, shoddy goods, hidden unemployment, all of those things. Capitalism was tried in countries like Pakistan and Iran. I remember talking to a World Bank official when I was a priest in Pakistan, and he said, look, we only know the rich, and we only work with the rich. We hope that what we do trickles down to the poor. At that time, I was working with brick kiln workers, bonded labor, and I said I couldn't see any signs of this trickle down amongst them. I mean, the World Bank has learned a lot of lessons since then. I don't want to accuse them today of doing what happened then. And in Iran, the Shah was building a kind of Switzerland in North Tehran with money from newly raised oil prices, and with the elite being people who either exported oil or imported arms. And this Switzerland was closed to people living in South Tehran in the slums. They couldn't enter. So when the Iranian Revolution began, what happened? The people of South Tehran marched into North Tehran and hung the people living there by the lampposts. That's what happened. Now, of course, there are these factors that have contributed. The rise of an urban class of mainly young males who have just enough education to know they're not getting what they deserve is certainly, in cities like Algiers, for instance, or Cairo, this is obvious. An urban, disenchanted class of young men, I think mostly it has to be said. But they have a parallel on the borders of Afghanistan and Pakistan. The Deobandi madrasas strung along that border recruit children whose parents cannot afford any other kind of education but to send them to these madrasas. And they then become the fodder. Hence the name Taliban. Taliban means students. And Taliban of where? Of these madrasas. Bring things to a close, out of all of this that has happened in the past and is happening today, there are certain issues for the future that I would like you to consider. I think the first is, what is the relationship of religion to public life? And Islamic resurgence in its various forms, not just extremism, I'm not just talking about extremism, has raised the question for us in a very sharp way. So that now the Westphalian consensus cannot any longer be held to be relevant. The question now is not whether religion should have a role in public life, but what kind of role it should have. What kind of role? And in this, I conducted a written dialogue with a man who was at that time the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court in Pakistan, Justice Naseem Hassan Shah. And one of his contributions, this was all published, he said that he believed in an Islamic State, but he believed the role of the Islamic State was to allow Muslims to be persuaded to be good Muslims, not coerced. Now, with that, I have no quarrel. You see, my quarrel, not just with Muslims, of course, but with anyone, is coercion. So the pattern of engagement in the public sphere has to be that of persuasion and not of coercion. To persuade, I mean religious people, to persuade in terms of public policy by the quality of their argument. Secondly, what is the relationship to democracy? Democracy has, of course, often arisen in a situation where there's been a dominance of the Judeo-Christian tradition. Or it has arisen in countries like India, where the dominant tradition has been, in an acknowledged way, modified by the Judeo-Christian tradition. I mean, if you want to go into that, there is quite a lot of literature. But the question is, what future will democracy have elsewhere? Does it have a future elsewhere? And what is that future? Now, of course, with Islam, for example, there are many things to be said about this. Whether the notion of shura can be developed in such a way as to lead to modern democratic ideas and practices. Well, some Muslims believe that. What about traditional forms of government by consent that are not Islamic but exist in Muslim majority countries? There are the practice of allegiance to someone who has already emerged as a ruler is certainly one example that can be given. In Afghanistan, what happened after the Taliban were removed was the revival of the Loya Jirga. See, the Loya Jirga is the idea of elders coming together to make decisions. In this case, it was modified so that it included women and younger people. And I think if democracy takes root in Afghanistan, it will be because of this kind of way in which their own institutions were used to promote democratic ideals. I asked about Iraq. I asked Tony Blair, actually, himself about Iraq, whether they would use traditional Iraqi methods of governance by consent in the future system. And he said, it's up to the Iraqi people. So I said, but you've also got something to do with what's going on. I couldn't pin him down. The problem, of course, in Iraq, as in many Ottoman background countries, is that because of the high levels of autonomy created by the Ottomans, among the millets, unitary government is very difficult. I mean, this is the same with the Balkans. So the solution will have to be some kind of federalist model, which continues to recognize the importance of the different communities. This has already happened in the north, by the way, with the Kurds, who are basically operating a state of their own. The other point, in the light of the so-called Arab Spring, that is worth making about democracy, is that it is not enough. I mean, I said this at the time of the various uprisings. If democracy is left on its own, it can simply result in a tyranny of the majority. That is no less tyranny because it's of the majority. So with democracy, you also need things like a Bill of Rights or some provision for common citizenship, equality of all under the law, one law for all of those things. And I hope, for example, in Egypt, that the new constitution will somehow recognize these things, as the Afghan constitution did by incorporating the United Nations Universal Declaration of Human Rights in the preamble. There is then also the question about the relationship of religion to law. Now, a law public law has developed a kind of autonomy, even though, as I said at the very beginning, the traditions of public law in different countries owe a great deal to the dominant religious traditions that have existed in those countries. You know, no one can deny this. But the autonomy is also important, that public law should not simply be the law of any particular religious community. When this comes to the question about Sharia, a number of things can be said. Because of the relationship of Sharia to public law in Muslim-majority countries, well, of course, in the development of public law, constitutional or statute or even case law, Sharia has to be taken into account. The most distinguished Chief Justice in Pakistan was a Christian. Chief Justice Cornelius was a very devout Roman Catholic, daily mass and all that kind of thing. And one day he was asked by a rather rude journalist who said, Justice Cornelius, how can you, a Christian, be the Chief Justice of an Islamic state? And he thought for a while and he said, but you see, constitutionally I'm a Muslim. Because he knew that in the business of law in Pakistan, Sharia had to be taken into account. But to what extent? And what kind of Sharia? Are we here talking only of the maqasid of Sharia? Or are we talking about a particular fiqh? Or, you know, what are we talking about? So the question in Egypt is whether Sharia is to be the sole source of law or one of the sources of law, and if one of the sources, what are going to be the other sources? You know, all of these questions have to be asked. Secondly, the long tradition, going back 200 years at least now, of Muslim thought about the principles of movement in Sharia. How are they going to be taken into account? From Shah Waliullah of Delhi, Muhammad Abduh in Egypt, Muhammad Iqbal in Pakistan, and in the Iranian tradition, certainly there's also been a great deal of thought in Fiqh Jafriya about the relationship of revelation to reason. I mean, one of the problems about radical Islamism is that it has obscured this debate about principles of movement which exist in the various sources of law in Islam already, and also whether principles of movement that do not exist can also be created. I mean, this is the real question today about Sharia and public law in Islamic countries. The third point about Sharia in the West particularly is whether the way in which Sharia is promoted in terms of radical Islamism, whether that is compatible with the basic orientation of Western public law traditions. My own view is that it is not. I mean, I'm not saying Sharia cannot be developed in particular ways. We have enough indication in the work of scholars even today, like Sheikh Ali Goma, that it could be. But if it is not, then there are basic tensions that we need to face up to. Fourthly and finally, reciprocity. You see, this is a question that keeps coming up. I am a strong advocate of religious freedom in every part of the world. And that means, of course, religious freedom for Muslims in the West or in countries like India. But I remember asking a Saudi, a very distinguished Saudi ambassador, why there were no churches in Saudi Arabia. And he said, and this was his answer, he said, but there are no mosques in the Vatican. Now, you know, this is not acceptable as an answer. Of course, reciprocity can begin to look like tit for tat, and I don't want it to. Dr. Haddad will remember that in our dialogue with Al-Azhar, we agreed that reciprocity should not mean tit for tat, but it should mean the common commitment of the partners in dialogue to fundamental freedoms. Wherever their writ runs, wherever they have power or influence or whatever it may be. I think that is the right way to think about reciprocity. Well, Madam Chair, you have been very patient. I will stop now and see what response there might be.
You've been wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you.